I'm Rory Miller, and David has made me talk about myself. So, martial history, you know, mom was a fencer, dad was a boxer and a bar brawler. I started formally in judo when I went to college at Oregon State Judo Team under Mike Moore and Wolfgang Dill. Extraordinary instructors, good training. We had a running joke for a long time that all you needed to take out the OSU judo team was catches after practice, because three nights a week we were too slagged to put on our own shirts. It was excellent training. And they set the bar for what I expected from an instructor ever since. I've studied a lot of other things and stayed for a very short time because the teaching did not come up to that standard. Judo was luck. At that time, it was 81, so consider it late 70s, early 80s. Martial arts was considered the way to become a complete person, and I lived in a rural, incredibly rural, very small town. No opportunity. As soon as I got to college, I went to the first martial art I could find. Happened to be judo. And judo is just good physics, good strategy, no mysticism, ruthless conditioning, ruthless timing. I loved it. Trained in judo, dabbled in everything else that the university offered. They had the associate students of OSU, where there were all kinds of classes you could take, as well as anything they had on the official program. Later, I stumbled into jujitsu. I was looking for a judo school. We just moved up to Portland. I was an arrogant young judoka who thought that judo was the end all and be all, that jujitsu was just primitive judo, not nearly as refined or good. And I stumbled into Dave Sumner's Soshitsu Dojo and got schooled. And Dave was pound for pound the best fighter I've ever seen and the best instructor for me ever. And it was most of what we did on the infighting video is the way that he trained, is working the infighting, because that's where it works. I've been a martial artist for, I think, 6 years when I was bouncing in Reno, and then 10 years when I started working corrections. So I spent 17 years working corrections. It was intense. When you're working booking, I probably average 2 force encounters a week. That being not anything small, but the stuff I had to write reports about, the high was 8 in 1 night. You get a lot of live fire experience, and it puts things in perspective. Martial arts is excellent training. You learn body mechanics, you learn what to do. But until you actually apply it, it's really hard to know, well, to know what you don't know, to know what's missing. I found that the longer I did it, then the more stuff I saw in the martial arts, not the less. I wasn't disappointed in it, but I needed to learn where it fit. And there were things I had to go to other schools for. So Soshitsu really doesn't have many submissions. It's got like 2. And formally, those are both used to disarm the guy and stick a knife in the back of his neck. To handcuff, I had to go to small circle jujitsu with Stan Miller, and that was fantastic, fun, good teachers. I started writing a confluence of 2 things, and you know, everyone always writes, everyone always has, but the actual writing stuff down that was important. I had a really interesting year. Body recovery, suicide of a friend, a whole bunch of stuff that happened all at once, and it wasn't settling like it should. At about the same time, Chris Wilder asked me to teach at a seminar, and in the seminar, I'm talking to a room full of martial artists. I've been a martial artist my whole life. It was like aliens. They didn't have a language for the stuff that I was talking about. I'd be talking about assaults and not fights, and this entire room of people been training there for years, 10, 20, 30 years, didn't know there was a difference. They didn't understand that self-defense was a legal concept. It wasn't a physical concept. These fundamental truths that, you know, because every force incident I had for the last probably 12 years had always involved, I needed to legally justify everything that I did. And that changed a lot. So I started writing. I was writing mostly in the first book, Meditations on Violence, whose working title was The Rhinoceros and the Unicorn, which if we'd run with that title, no one would have ever read it. So I want to thank YMAA for changing the title. But Meditations on Violence was getting the stuff out of my head that I wasn't processing from the big events of that year, and also to try to write something. And I originally envisioned it for my students so they would understand some of the things that it takes a little bit of live fire to understand. Meditations is a core dump. It's just a big psychic vomit of the shit that was in my head at the time. After it came out, actually, the month that it came out, I went to Iraq as a contractor. And I continued writing there. I wrote Facing Violence because someone had pointed out that meditation was a list of questions I needed some answers. And Facing Violence are the seven things I think you have to cover if you want to call it self-defense. If you leave out any of the seven, your students are vulnerable. Also, I was in Iraq, I was writing Forced Decisions, and that was just because I was so tired of people getting on YouTube or getting on the internet talking about a forced incident with police officers and saying it was bad or wrong when I'm looking at the same thing going, it was normal, it was justified. And I wanted to write a book so that the people that were upset, and any use of force looks wrong, it looks upsetting to anyone that's not used to them. It takes some skill and some experience to sit there and go, this is good, this was bad. Every use of force will make you feel icky if you've never exposed it before. And if you think feeling icky is wrong, you'll want to make it not happen. I have no problem working for the public. I had no problem that I was using force in the name of the public. I have no problem with the public telling me how to use force. But I have a serious problem with people doing it based on emotion and not on the rules. If I break a rule, I totally need to be reined in. But in order for someone to say that, they need to understand the rules. So Forced Decisions was to write down the first section, a use of force class, the way officers get it. And the second section was on how living with that kind of violence force, living as they think, changes your perspective, changes who you are, changes what you do. It doesn't turn you into a bad person, it doesn't do anything like that, but you start to think that this is normal, this is not normal. And violence is way more normal than we want to believe it is. A couple things happened about that time. Lawrence asked me to collaborate on Scaling Force, and we just did a video on it. But the basic thing is that not everything can be handled with a kick to the head, and not everything can be handled with a wrist lock, and not everything can be handled with a kind word. And if you don't have a range of options from just being a good witness, or like we called it in the book, doing nothing skillfully, through talking and up into control, fighting, and lethal force, if you don't have options at all those levels, there are situations you do not have options for. And you need to understand that, fill any gaps in your training if you want to be fully functional. About the same time, Mark McYoung contacted me to say that he'd just done a de-escalation course for a bunch of cops in Germany. And he realized that about half the half of the information had come out of meditations. He wanted to know if I wanted to collaborate on a communications course. I just finished Facing Violence and YMAA, and that had a breakdown of violence in there based on Maslow that worked really well. And that became the first underpinning for the conflict communications course. CONCOM completely exceed our expectations. We had originally been planning a course for cops on how to talk down bad guys, how to control violent people. Our beta tester groups were sitting there saying, yes, this is fantastic for that, but it also explains my boss and explains my family. And we were having people that are starting to use it to make all their communication better, to make all their conflict go away. We had, this sounds really arrogant and it's actually kind of scary to say, but it looks like we have stumbled on the Rosetta Stone for all conflict. An actual taxonomy such that you can identify it and manipulate it. And that's, I know how arrogant that sounds, but I think we did it. And CONCOM, the last book is out on ebook. It probably won't be out in print for another year, is powerful. Drills also will be coming out hopefully in paper in about a year. It's the training methods that I use. From the most basic to the most advanced, training of mind as much as training the body. The other two videos that come out, we did a Facing Violence video, which is a tie into the book. Logic of Violence happened because someone sent me a video of his new self-defense system, and I realized everything in there. He'd been a bouncer, he had hundreds of encounters, he'd done a good job, but it was basically a video on how a well-trained, fit martial artist could beat up a drunk college kid. Because he'd had so many encounters, he thought that it was all violence was the same. And I realized we needed to break down. Nothing in there could be used by a 110-pound drunk college girl who was being targeted by the same drunk college kid that he was used to taking down. So we started doing a couple of seminars, a program, Logic of Violence, where I give you the problems a criminal has to solve. And the students solve them. They figure out a crime from the ground up, what you need to do to be a successful criminal. And in that list of coming up with the stuff a criminal needs to do, it tells you 90% of what you need to do to avoid being targeted. It's really important for self-defense instructors to start breaking it down that way. Joint locks and the one we just filmed today, joint locks and infighting, are more martial arts than self-defense. My big thing with joint locks is, actually my big thing with a lot of things, martial arts, the body mechanics tend to be very efficient, but I can't help that think that we teach them in almost the worst possible way to use things in an emergency. Memorizing thousands of techniques doesn't help. Getting things down by rote that you need to apply in chaotic situations is almost counterproductive. When we were tasked at the sheriff's office to change our DTs because we were getting too many officers hurt, Mac and I started working on changing the training methods. And joint locks is one example of that. We were getting officers with no experience whatsoever improvising locks under pressure in under an hour. And I can tell you from experience that most people that study joint locking art in 8 years can't improvise under pressure. The difference wasn't the techniques, the difference was the teaching methods. And my one big goal for joint locks is joint locks are a little bit of a specialty of mine. I want people to have other specialties like striking, grappling, throwing, to be able to look at the teaching methods and sit there and go, shit, we can make it faster. My goal as a teacher is to get people better than I do faster than it took me to get here. I think that's the only honorable goal for a teacher, is to make students who are better than you. And if you're a good teacher, you'll make them there faster than it took you. This is a little bit of a buzz line, but we've been working so hard on being able to fight ruthlessly. Ruthless efficiency is the hallmark of all good fighting. There's no reason why we can't teach ruthlessly efficiently. How well can we teach? That's going to be the challenge for the next generation, is how good we can get people, how fast, how well can we teach? So I guess that's my challenge to you, and that's what joint locks was about. David, right there, just asked me what's the problem with MMA. It's not a problem. For one thing, I see two distinctions. And this is the same distinction in not just in every other martial art, but in everything in the world. There are the serious people and the wannabes. And the serious people are almost never a problem. The people that get the t-shirts, that watch it, and they think because they watch it and get the t-shirts, they know what they're talking about. And they get religious and they have their stars. They're just like the drunk guys at the bar who've never played football, but watch it, and they'll get in a fight with you if you disrespect their team. I never see that from the serious guys. There's some element of showmanship to the high-level guys, just like there is in any sport, and that can come across. But all the ones I've met in person have been mellow, they've been cool. One of the valuable things about MMA is that every young man wants to test himself. And boxing, wrestling are all ways to do it, but MMA allows that, plus a level of strategy that's, in my opinion, a step beyond the other martial sports. This is fantastic. It wasn't on the radar screen when I was coming up. The closest I got was the sports jujitsu. But they test themselves. And I have no problem with guys that test themselves. I have a big issue with the guys that talk about them testing themselves and watch it on TV instead of playing. And those are, I think, most of the people when David's talking about the MMA mentality that bothers him. I think he's talking mostly about the wannabes, not the people that play. It's good skills. Like anything else, it is what it is. It's not more than that. So, and that goes for anything out there. I love my judo, but judo was judo. Judo was not self-defense. A lot of the skills were applicable. A lot of the stuff I could turn around. I love the fact that it got used to me grabbing someone who was bigger and sweaty and nasty and using better physics than he did to put him on the ground and make sure he couldn't move. That's a skill, and I love that skill. But it's a piece of other things. Nothing is complete. Good enough? Okay, am I done?
Yeah, you're done.
Good, thank God.
You did so good.
Thank you.